He was actually the first science support branch chief at the Storm Prediction Center, and has received numerous awards, as well as a fellow of the American Meteorological Society in 2012. He'll be speaking on tornadoes, derechos, and the Storm Prediction Center. So without further ado, Dr. Schneider.
Today.
We'll go through a lot of different material, kind of recap some of the events, the historic events of 2011, as well as take a look at the events, the fewer events, but some very large events in 2012. Do a little bit that's a little nerdy science about the nature of storms. We may have to turn off this other mic so we don't get a feedback thing going. And then we'll finish up with what's coming to the Storm Prediction Center this year. That may be able to help you, maybe too advanced, but it depends on the audience. This is a tough audience to get an exact bead on what your interests will be. Oops, let's see, how do I get this to go forward? This would be nice if it went forward. There we go, no. I've tried every button. Oops, now we go. Of course, I don't know which one I pressed. That's the problem. We'll figure it out again. Anyway, it's not surprising that we're here talking about tornadoes. Worldwide, we're really at the epicenter of tornadoes, almost right at this room. The epicenter is probably a little bit south of here, but pretty darn close to the epicenter of tornado activity worldwide, right where we're standing. And so we need to be vigilant every year. 2011 was no exception, and I don't know what button it is. Okay. All right, next one. So at Storm Prediction Center, we're here to protect lives and property and to give people forewarning. We mainly go 8 days in advance down close to the storm. You've seen our tornado watches, which we do in collaboration with the local forecast offices. Everything we do is done in close collaboration with local forecast offices. So we try and present as unified a picture of the severe weather threat as possible. Next one. So 8 days in advance to a few minutes in advance, we're very engaged with the research community. We're in close partnership with the National Weather Service on a routine basis, but we certainly consider emergency management, spotters, media, private sector, all part of a really critical partnership, and we'll come back to that again. We're not gonna be able to really save lives without the entire partnership working effectively together. Go ahead. So at SBC, we're mainly focusing a little bit longer time range, although we provide continuous updates even after the watch is issued within our mesoscale discussions. You'll see some evolution in these as we move forward. We're trying to add more plain language discussions in addition to the more detailed scientific discussions. So keep an eye on our website, and if you haven't visited it before, please do. It's at sbc.noaa.gov. Next one. So each year, about 1,500 tornadoes, about $1 billion in damage, and around 80 fatalities, but there's wide variability from year to year, as you know now. And so the 80 fatalities is on average. This is a large tornado near Omaha back in 1975. Next. In 2011, 1,700 tornadoes, so a very large number of tornadoes. $25 billion in damage, that's an estimate, and pretty close to spot on from insurance estimates, and 553 fatalities, which was really quite sobering. This was my first year as director of Storm Prediction Center. I'd been science support branch chief for about 14 years prior, so it wasn't a total shock. We've been preparing for a year like this, but when it unfolds, it's definitely sobering and tiring really a sad year in tornado history. Go ahead to the next one. So this is the way it started out. This was out in North Carolina, April 16th. This was the first big outbreak of the year, and most years this would have been the big one. You can see the isolated supercells, as John was just talking about, moving rapidly northeast, where each of those accompanied by numerous tornadoes. A large tornado came through Raleigh. Fortunately, it wasn't in its most mature stage as it came through Raleigh, North Carolina. Still, 26 fatalities and over about a half billion dollars in damage. This next video is from he's not a spotter, but this is the example of someone that's maybe a little bit too calm and probably doesn't really know what he's doing. Go ahead. Hopefully we can hear the audio. We need a little audio. Yeah, he's gonna have to look around for it. Maybe we can go back once we find it. But anyway, this guy is, without the audio, you're gonna miss the main point of this. He's sitting here in his car, and he's watching, that's a tornado that's coming at him. And he's cognizant that it's a tornado, but he doesn't think it's very strong, because it's just throwing paper around through the air. Unfortunately, those are roofs. So he realized there was a power flash as he's talking to his sister on the cell phone. He's saying, well, don't worry, it's not too bad. Not too bad. Don't worry. All right, without the audio, we're losing a little bit of this, but here it comes. So during this whole thing, he's saying, don't worry, I'm okay, I'm okay, I'm okay. And then at the end here, he says, well, I got a little problem. My car is damaged. But this guy was stone cold calm as this tornado approached him, a little bit too calm. Hopefully we can get the audio in the future, some of the other videos. Otherwise, we'll just have to go with my communication. Go ahead to the next frame. Okay, so then just April 22nd, we're only 6 days later. Here's an EF4 tornado. It wasn't a super wide body EF4, but you can see the damage in this one suburban neighborhood, quite extensive. But this tornado goes right across St. Louis Airport. Now, this next video is in the terminal. There is no sound with it. But this is a classic, both from a emergency management as well as just an awareness. Fortunately, no fatalities. I'd have to say, and if you watched the video, you'd say we were really quite fortunate to have no fatalities. There were actually airplanes on the tarmac with passengers on board in ground stop. They're ground stop because of the lightning. And yet there's passengers on the planes and the pilots don't even know a tornado is approaching the airport because the communication is very complex in an airport. The handoff between the tower, the airline, and the FAA is quite complex. And so some of these communication situations are very challenging. Let's go to the video. So you'll see who's smarter than the others. I think that's smart. Now the one fellow stands there and reconnoiters the situation. You can see the inflow into the vortex, apparently. Some people in the background are starting to head for cover. That's a good thing. Here comes TSA. So, EF4, at this point, was very narrow, goes right and hits a terminal. There are a lot of people still in that terminal, and you'll see them emerging from the dust in the background. And airplanes on the tarmac with jet fuel on them. I'd say we were more fortunate than skillful in this situation. But it points towards the real complexity, both in large venues, locations like airports, and the critical nature of spotting as well as emergency management and getting people prepared and having an effective plan. Let's go to the next one. So now we get to an incredible historic day. The 26th was actually very active as well. The 25th, no slouch. But this was a truly historic event. Very large tornadoes on the 27th of April. Throughout much of Alabama, portions of Mississippi, up into Tennessee, and up the entire East Coast. Very well forecast, still approximately 300 fatalities on this day alone. a day that we hadn't experienced in many decades within the United States. Large violent tornado through Tuscaloosa, as well as several others in the affected area. Let's go to the next slide. So we really had very effective forecasts and outlooks. These were communicated pretty well through the media, but in the end, we still had approximately 300 fatalities, which has really caused a lot of soul searching in the aftermath of this. I think that kind of effort was in existence before, but it's really given new urgency the importance of us all working together to get the message out and to get people prepared for severe convection and these large tornado and tornado outbreaks when they occur. Let's go to the next slide. So this is the tornado as it's going through Tuscaloosa, and we don't have the volume. This is someone who's essentially left their, it appears that they left their apartment or home to drive out of the path, and they're in a large mall parking lot. But I don't think we should lose track. A lot of times when they're out over open countryside, it doesn't seem quite so menacing, but you get these into an urban area, and this can certainly happen here, right in Lawrence. Certainly it happened in Topeka in the mid-1960s. Omaha, turn of the century, this is bad. Yeah, here's a little volume. Can't keep the camera steady. Incredible vortex going through Tuscaloosa, an incredible tragedy in its wake. Very large, and sometimes difficult for people to identify as a tornado when they are getting this large. I think people struggle with whether it's a cloud or a tornado. And they're moving very rapidly, and as I frequently say, they're not obeying traffic laws. And unfortunately, it is very difficult in these urban environments to get out of their way. Let's go to the next one. This one illustrates the complexity and diversity of the folks that we're trying to warn. This is a Hispanic-speaking community family. I mean, a car just getting home. They've got about 50 seconds or 60 seconds. So the reality is this will happen in our communities, these bad days. Don't go to the window. Video from that day within a urban area, and we really need to be prepared for these days. They're extremely rare, but when they happen, all the planning that you've done can make all the difference in the world. Go ahead. So both horrific and incredible impacts. And this one is you can see the devastation in the housing, churned up soil here in Mississippi. This was with an EF5. I mean, this is actually a very deep rut in this particular field. I'm sure it had something unique to do with that specific field. This is a Ford Explorer of Smithville, Mississippi. They knew exactly where it was parked because it still had its plate on it, and the person knew where he parked it. It flew a half mile through the air. It ricocheted off the water tower and then flew another quarter mile and landed here, and this is a Ford Explorer. The paint matched. There's a big dent in the water tower. So staying in your car, not a great thing. Next one. We won't talk more about Joplin. I know you had talked about it last year, but incredibly tragic. And you can see the widening of the path as the tornado intensified, widened, and then actually slowed as it went through this very dense residential neighborhood. The dangers of these large box stores, the total collapse of these buildings due to the nature of their really large frame across the main shopping area. A lot of floor space, but it makes it very vulnerable to a total collapse. And in this case, a primary medical facility taken out at the same time as it would be most needed. Go ahead. So in the end, this was a truly historic year. It turned out, after everything was counted, that came up with 553 direct tornado fatalities, which is the second deadliest in the combined record. And the next talk will focus on the deadliest year, which is essentially the deadliest tornado in U.S. history, 1925. Next. I think Harold showed this last year, a much higher, this is normalized fatalities by population in the United States. There's been a nice decreasing trend, but it's much more dangerous within mobile and manufactured homes. Even permanent homes, some will vary considerably in their construction quality, but the odds of a fatality if you're well sheltered in them is much lower than if you're in these mobile homes or manufactured homes. Next one. So we'll tick through a few years. There's been this downward trend, but 2011 put an end to that. And next. Back in 1974, next one, the super outbreak, which was really what a lot of us were preparing for. And 27 April 2011 was very similar in magnitude, a little different in its spatial characteristics, but very intense. 366 fatalities, including 34 in Xenia, Ohio. This is the tornado that was moving through Xenia, Ohio on that particular day. But this was all before we had all the advances in weather radar, and the satellite imagery was in its initial phase. Numerical model weather prediction has gotten so much better. And yet we still had death tolls that exceeded 1974 and 2011. So it's more than just the science. We've got to get the word out, and people have to have effective plans. And safe shelter action options in order to save lives. Let's go to the next one. We'll tick through these pretty quickly. 1953, also very high death toll. Next slide. Waco, Texas. This is a furniture store that totally collapsed during the Waco tornado. Over 30 fatalities in this store alone. 114 fatalities with this EF5 that went right through the heart of Waco. Next slide. Later in the year, in June, Flint, Michigan. This is a residential neighborhood. It looks very similar in some ways to some of the neighborhoods in Joplin, Missouri. The tornado came into town largely unannounced, although there was a police officer that drove with his sirens on, which gave some indication, but there was very few shelter options. 116 fatalities on this day in June 1953. The very next day in Worcester, another strong, violent tornado, this time out in Massachusetts. Just because you're near the East Coast doesn't mean you're safe. You can see this structure. This would be quite menacing on the Great Plains, but to have it in Massachusetts is rare, but it can happen. Now here's the hook echo. This is a very early MIT radar with a hook echo, long track tornado family, and severe devastation in some of the housing areas, 90 fatalities. Go ahead to the next. Back in 1936, again, the next slide. Tupelo, Mississippi, Gainesville, Georgia. 552 fatalities on the entire year. 216 on the evening of, I guess they don't have the date here, on the evening of the 5th, 216 fatalities in Tupelo, Mississippi. Another 203 the following morning at 8:30 in the morning in Gainesville, Georgia, just during the morning rush hour. Incredible, over 400 fatalities in a 24-hour period with two separate tornadoes. Next. And 1925, we'll go through this very quickly because the next talk, go ahead, is about it. Chuck will be talking about the tri-state tornado. This was an early representation of the track. He'll have a lot more detail on that, associated with strong, larger scale cyclone, and I'm sure Chuck will talk about that as well. But 695 fatalities approximately. during a 3 to 4 hour period as this storm moved very rapidly, 50, 60 mile an hour forward translation. So the warnings were very much complicated by these incredible forward speeds on these storms, and that happens to us today. These big outbreak days, the tornadoes are big and they are moving very rapidly. Next one. So you see the tri-state here, which we'll talk about next, or Chuck will talk about next. 2011 all the way up here in the Rogues Gallery, second place, which is incredible given how much we invest in weather warnings. Poplar Bluff, Missouri, and St. Louis has been hit a number of times and contributed to very high fatality counts. Of course, back in 1913, Omaha suffered devastation. It would be much worse today with urban sprawl as it is. Let's go ahead. So we've really convened some large meetings, but meetings don't get it done. What we need is to work together. It's not just the weather forecast. If we don't have folks like you monitoring for the storms and also getting the information out effectively, preparing the public for what they need to do on these very bad days, they're going to be very rare, and so it's hard to keep vigilance up. But if it's not planned for in advance, it's really going to be a tragedy for your community or a community near you and maybe your family or friends. Let's go to the next one. So 2012, it started out very aggressively, so people started saying it's just a rerun. We really don't have a lot of skill in terms of long-range tornado forecasting at this point. Let's go to the next slide. Very strong start. Go ahead, next. And a very quiet remainder of the year, really through April 14th. It was a really active start to the year, and then really quite quiet for the most part the rest of the year. Let's go to the next. So the big dates, and we're just going to talk about the end of February as well as March 2nd, and then the 14 April event here in the Great Plains. Go ahead. So with a below normal year for watches and warnings, there's a severe thunderstorm watches and tornado watches, very low counts, and up here probably not too many tornado watches, but you can't rest on this obviously for the next year. Let's go ahead. Here's the warnings. You can even see the 14 April outbreak quite clear with the isolated supercells on that particular day. Go ahead. And here's the tornadoes. These are the long track supercells from the 14th of April mixed in with some other events. Here's Branson. Go ahead. That's all right. Branson was one of the first events. It was in the evening hours. Not 15 killed in Branson, 3 fatalities in Missouri in the overnight. But a lot of damage to the resort community. Very complex had this been in summer or earlier in maybe at spring break. Branson not particularly heavily populated with tourists in February. Let's go to the next one. This was a real horrific event. Harrisburg, Illinois, 5 in the morning, which is really difficult to get the word out for. Strong supercell. These aren't the worst damaged homes. They never take the pictures of the worst damage because there's not much to take a picture of. And in this case, 8 fatalities, over 100 injuries with an EF4. And when you start seeing the insulation pasted up in trees. Fortunately, this hadn't opened yet. This is one of those strip malls. So a lot of these strip malls, people will run and take shelter in them, but they're not all that well constructed for storms in a lot of cases. Let's go on. March 2nd was a really incredible outbreak. It wasn't as big as some of the events of 2011, so we might tend to, it's a little bit in their shadow, but this was an impressive tornado outbreak, particularly across, I'm going to press the, no? Okay, I'm thinking I'm actually controlling it. a long track supercell across southern Indiana and Ohio, a lot of tornadoes in Tennessee and Kentucky late in the evening. School buses affected near Henryville. Fortunately, the children were off them, but they had already been loaded. They unloaded them again. Again, this timing of the tornado relative to schools opening and closing is a key thing. 69 tornadoes with 40 fatalities. Let's go to the next image. We had a good outlook on it. Here's the way things started out. And the isolated supercell comes from these small isolated storms in the southwest portion of the first tornado watch that was issued at 10 in the morning, real strong forcing. There's actually already a tornado in progress down here near Huntsville. This was a real tough one. This is a pretty strong tornado. By late in the day, a whole bevy of tornado watches, high-risk areas, beginning to be cleared out. We can see the isolated supercells, and particularly in eastern Kentucky. Let's go to the next one. Here's a little bit further on. This is the one that emerged out of that initial convection. This is a really intense. This is still in the tornado watch here. The downstream watch has already been issued. This isolated supercell is the one that tears through Hudsonville and hits the school there. And this next video will be the tornado going through Hudsonville. Or Henryville, sorry, Hudsonville. Hudsonville is a different tornado. I've edited out the swearing, so. Again, these tornadoes on these big days, they are moving 50 miles an hour. They're in your town, you see approaching. They're in, doing their damage, and they're moving on to the next community. It's over fast, but probably an eternity if you're inside the vortex. Let's move on to the next one. So a bad day in southern Indiana and Kentucky. A lot of damage, a lot of fatalities, really impressive tornadoes early in the year on March 2nd. And you know the date right now. So if we can get the moisture back, the shear is very strong. So you always need to monitor for these next few systems in the early season. Let's go to the next, click a couple more times. So 58 fatalities through March. That brought us to April 3rd. This was in the Dallas Metroplex. A boundary set up. We got a tornado watch out just as storms were initiating this stationary boundary. Each of the storms started to rotate right as they're approaching the downtown Dallas Metroplex. These are, I wish they were my trucks, but they are Schneider trucks flying through the air. These are all tractor trailers that were picked up by this tornado that was heading right towards downtown Dallas. No fatalities, two EF3s and three EF2s, but it really did not look like a classic setup, but you had a nice boundary and then storms initiating right near it. And so it turned very quickly from a fairly mundane day to a significant tornado day. Next. This is an image as one of the board is, oops, I am controlling it. Wow. Anyway, as one of the tornadoes is coming through town, this whole condensation funnel is very large. Remember, you're north of the warm front, so the condensation funnel is going to be real large because it's almost cloudy, it's almost fog there. And so you're going to get a very impressive condensation funnel, visually impressive, but probably a smaller damage area. But still a tornado in an urban environment, you can see all the cars. Go ahead, Matt. Oh, I can do next. Here we go. I got to regain control of my own car. Here's the 13th of April. We're really pointing towards the 14th of April, but this goes to show that the day before the big day or the day just after the big day could be your big day. This is a big day for Norman, Oklahoma. In the end, we end up being fortunate, but the ingredients are just starting to come into place across the southern plains. In the late afternoon, Norman, Oklahoma, our hometown, was very fortunate. Generally, tornado watch in effect, generally severe thunderstorms. One takes a quick right turn, intensifies, takes a strong right turn just outside of Norman, and the circulation moves right through Norman, Oklahoma. And it was accompanied by a tornado. Now when you look at the path, this is right as it's approaching I-35, a little bit rain ramped. It's not an absolute classic day. In the end, this tornado goes right through the heart of Norman, Oklahoma. This is right along the interstate, a lot of shopping centers. Goes across numerous schools. This is the main high school, I think, right here. Right across City Hall and the police department. This is the main hospital. So sometimes the tracks are amongst the worst that you can imagine, and you need to be prepared for those. This is the police department. And the response of Norman, you would hope it would be fantastic, but it was not particularly good on this day. This is before the vortex gets there. Here we come. And the main tornado went a little bit north of here. We're on the edge of it. But you can imagine, you could have knocked out the main response, you could have knocked out the hospital, hit mass casualties in schools. This ended up being a very weak tornado, but it cranked up just outside of town, just like Joplin. So you can go from a fairly benign situation to really having wished you'd done your homework in advance in a very quick period of time. All right, the next day is the 14th of April. We already saw some pictures. Incredible tornadoes across Kansas. Fortunately, the vast majority of them avoided the larger population centers as well as most of the small towns. Could have been much worse. These were large, long-lived supercells with long-track tornadoes. Quite a bit of damage, but quite a bit of damage in open fields as well, which is good. Wichita obviously wasn't, Southeast Wichita wasn't so lucky, and there were other communities that were affected. I'm not trying to minimize that, but we were fortunate on this day in terms of the exact track of the storms. And you're not always going to be fortunate. On this day also, we had really good outlooks well in advance. And we're very proud of that, but with the high risk on day two, that was one of the first times we'd ever done that. And we took some unusual steps based on the lessons we learned from 2011. Six fatalities in Woodward, and the very last storm, this is another one of those lessons, it was the very last supercell of the day, right near midnight in Woodward, Oklahoma. Person had been working all day on all those isolated storms. This is the storm that kills six people. Very difficult on that emergency manager and that spotting group because they've been at it all day. But until the risk is over, you don't know if it's going to be the first storm that's your worst one or the last one. You have to stay vigilant through the whole thing. It's going to require discipline. So based on the impacts, we went out on a limb and we did a press conference the day in advance, which is, I gave the press conference, the media interviews with the director of the Weather Service, and it is a little nerve-wracking to say there are going to be large, violent tornadoes the next day. It's nice and sunny right now, but all hell's going to break loose tomorrow. We're not clairvoyant, so we do our very best to forecast these things. We had a high risk out. We communicated that high risk effectively, and there were significant impacts. But the editorials, as well as even politicians that aren't always friendly to the federal government, believe that this took, that the entire system, it's not all about the SBC, it's not all about the Weather Service, it's also about our partners in media and emergency management. The message got out for this event, and people took it seriously, and people felt very well prepared for it. We were fortunate in the path of some of those storms, but we're going to try and replicate this when we have the confidence to do so again in the future. So 68 fatalities overall in 2012, many of them on March 2nd, and some of them earlier in the year in January down in Alabama. So derecho. We just got about 10, 15 minutes to go. We'll go a little bit over derechos, and I think I'm going to skip over that dirty stuff. But derecho is a word that came into our lexicon for some of us just this year, although it's been out there for a long time. This is a Boeing protective system, just like John talked about, but these are extremely well-organized, very strong, long-lived, damaging wind events. Generally, by the definition right now, we can't tell you it was a derecho until it's over, which isn't ideal. We certainly know when there's characteristics where we could have a derecho, but these are kind of like violent tornadoes. They're very well-organized, damaging wind events, but when they become extremely well-organized, the amount of damage and havoc they can wreak is considerable. There's two primary types. Serial derechos, a lot of times you get those in the early spring around here. A lot of them will be potential tornado outbreaks as well. There's substantial shear on these days, quite a bit of instability, but it'll be the type of convection that we get on that day. Things will be more linear, and a lot of times folks and chasers will be disappointed because they don't think they're going to see tornadoes. That doesn't mean it's not going to be a big day for people's lives, because these very strong damaging wind events can have some extreme wind with them, and particularly if you're in mobile homes or manufactured homes, there is potentially deadly as a tornado because these winds might be 80 to 100 miles an hour. So those generally are more cool season, the serial derechos. The progressive derechos are more in the deep warm season, over July, late June, much of July. Generally in the northern United States, although there's progressive derechos that would also occur in the Great Plains, and they'll dive just due southward right into the low-level jet in many cases. Let's look at a few examples of them. This is one up in northern Wisconsin. What's neat about this is Ted Fujita, who's a famous professor, analyzed it in great detail. And you can see the localized nature, the dark reds are the strongest wind damages. He estimated it as F2. He might have been a little aggressive on the wind speeds. It was based predominantly on tree damage, although Phillips, Wisconsin, had extensive housing damage on this day, both from the falling trees as well as the wind itself. So this is a very rapidly moving storm. Derechos are moving at 50, 60, 70 miles an hour. So they are on you fast. A lot of times boaters are in real trouble on these because by the time they realize the thunderstorm's about to occur, it's on them really quickly. So a lot of the fatalities are with campers, people on lakes, and out on waterways, particularly on boats, are in the greatest harm, and in manufactured housing. Here's a few in the Great Plains. Back in 1982, this derecho knocked out power to most of the northern half of Kansas City as it roared through in the early morning hours. Some call this the people chaser because people went up to go chasing in Kansas and got chased back home by a derecho. Those Oklahomans that went up to Kansas to see a tornado ended up being chased back to the south by a significant derecho. And these are some of the pictures from that particular storm. But they'll do a lot of damage. This is what we call the super derecho. It was an incredible derecho. 100 mile an hour winds in portions of Missouri. This is kind of a time lapse where you've stapled all the radar on top of each other. You can see its genesis back over western Kansas and not dissipating until it's almost exiting Kentucky with tornadoes, quite a few tornadoes in this particular event during its mature phase over Missouri. So derechos and these strong damaging bow wind events can actually have significant tornado outbreaks or events associated with them. Usually isolated, but occasionally not so isolated. Here's some other ones. Look at how fast they're moving, 47 miles an hour, 70 miles an hour, 52 miles an hour, 70 miles an hour. This is the super derecho with 6 fatalities, 40 injuries, and almost $500 million in damage. 40 tornadoes, including 2 EF3s. So it's not just wind damage, you can have some significant tornadoes. Here's a time lapse of the radar as you're moving along with it. This was put together by Jim Ledoux. And you can see how well organized these systems become. This one was very unique in that it had a different characteristic back in here, and there was actually very strong damaging wind all the way back here by the what would normally be a mid-level vortex with fairly cool air below it. There was actually very strong damaging wind in this case, and that may have contributed to the magnitude of the tornado threat along the leading edge of this convection, where there were isolated supercells or rotations that moved northward along this leading line of convection. And if I show the velocity data, you'd see the strong mesocyclones with each of those. So this year, it was a derecho in the east that made all the headlines, certainly affected a lot of people, took shape over northern Chicago and dove rapidly southeastward, 700 miles in 10 hours. Hurricane force winds, going from essentially zero to hurricane force winds in 2 to 3 hours, and then parading all the way to the Mid-Atlantic. Here it comes. These are hard to forecast days in advance. The conditions are there, but you're either going to get nothing, but if things get well organized and they're well situated, it can be one of the big severe weather events of the year. We had it well covered within watches, lay them out. We try and put them out way in advance before the storms even get there. This is at 6:30 in the evening. You can see it's still in Ohio. And yet within 4 hours, it's going to be going, 3 to 4 hours, it's going to be going through the Washington, D.C. area. So people have a feeling that they haven't been warned very well. It's very hard to communicate ahead of these systems once they get well organized. So almost 5 million people without power for this particular event, sometimes extending out to 6 days. With temperatures approaching the upper 90s, in some cases 100. So quite a bit of displeasure for folks impacted by this, and also 22 fatalities from falling trees as this system made its way across the country. We're going to skip over this tornado environment stuff. A lot of this is going to be out on our website. This is a little bit about where tornadoes occur within the Cape Shear space. If you're real familiar, you'll be able to garner it quickly, but we want this deep layer shear in order to organize the thunderstorms and make them more powerful. Or turn them into supercells. Sorry, I'm being a little bit too casual. You can see this is where tornadoes occur. Remember, across the bottom, this is increasing instability, more hot, humid air with cool air aloft. This is Cape. And then this is the deep layer shear that's going to organize it into a supercell. There's other metrics that you're going to want to look at, but generally greater than 30 knots, where most of the supercells are going to occur, greater than 40 knots, are you really into prime supercell territory. But a lot of the tornadoes are occurring in very low instability environments. About 87% of all the tornadoes in this sample from 2003 to present were greater than 30 knots of deep layer shear. Significant tornadoes, F2 to F5 tornadoes, 98% of them greater than 30 knots of deep layer shear. So the weaker tornadoes, which we were talking about in the last talk, sometimes with weaker shear, but these really strong tornadoes that cause the vast majority of damage and fatalities occur with very strong shear, but they also occur with fairly limited instability. And so instability, waiting for the super hot, humid day, is not key to strong, violent tornadoes. Really, whenever you get this extreme shear, you have the opportunity. So significant tornadoes in that general area. Very strong F3 to F5. You can see almost, essentially all of them greater than 30 knots, almost all of them greater than 40 knots, except when you get out towards this more extreme instability, very large instabilities that you might find a little later in the season. So this is actually the conditional probabilities, which is how, given that you have a thunderstorm and you're somewhere in this space, how likely is it that you have a tornado? And you can see a shape that does include greater instability does increase your chance of tornadoes. But down in here, the number of hours we spend in here is a lot. We spend a lot of hours, particularly in the southeast United States, in these very low instability environments. And that overlaps with significant tornadoes, and it's an environment where there's a lot of thunderstorms. So this is a very difficult environment for us to forecast for. We're going to have to issue a lot of tornado watches for those. It's relatively rare to get. You don't get tornadoes as frequently with these events, but over the passage of time, you will accumulate a lot of tornadoes, including significant tornadoes. So you're going to have to put up with more of a false alarm rate, because out in advance, we can't know whether or not a storm is going to take on strong rotational characteristics. But once they get organized, they are highly capable of producing strong tornadoes. This is where all the fatalities have occurred over the last decade or so. You see there's quite a few fatalities, even when the instability is very low. But as long as you've got that strong shear, a storm can organize into a very intense storm, intense supercell, and support violent tornadoes and a lot of fatalities. This is the environment associated with the 27th of April, 2011, very high-end environment, easy to identify. Joplin is in the extreme instability portion of the spectrum, but still quite strong vertical wind shear. Joplin's large fatality count is out there, a little bit of an outlier. So finally, just a couple quick things. What you're going to see at the SBC this year, this is coming to us this spring. We'll be remodeling our website. I think you're going to find it very useful. It's a little situational awareness tool. All this content will evolve based on the day. Headline of the day, kind of this is part very similar to what we currently have. Then we'll highlight which products have just recently come out, how current they are. So you'll have kind of a situational awareness display where you can get to the mesoscale discussions that are for your area very quickly. There will be additional public awareness information out there, as well as some of our guidance tools that are for more weather forecast community. We also have just put out this environment browser, which is out on our website. You can find it there. Very sophisticated, looks at all of the tornado environments across the United States over the last decade. You can do some very detailed analysis using this tool. It's done by some great work by Brian Smith, Richard Thompson, but also supported by many others at Storm Prediction Center to build this remarkable database. It's really worth taking a moment and looking at it. If you're a little bit more on the detailed side of tornado forecasting, this is the way it's done in real life. The storm scale ensemble of opportunity, that's out on the website. These are high resolution numerical models. They're not perfect, and what an ensemble is trying to blend all these computer models together to get a probabilistic map of where tornadoes and other severe storms are going to be most likely. Again, this is mainly for specialists, but it's the first resource of its kind that's available out on the web. And it uses very high resolution models that are beginning to crudely resolve individual thunderstorms, including supercells, in a very gross sense, and can provide useful guidance when we move into severe weather season. We'll also be adding some population information to our Outlook pages. So we're using these shapes in order to garner how many people, how many square miles, and how many people are potentially affected by these. It can be helpful, particularly for FEMA, but perhaps for media as well, to give people an idea of the numbers of people that might be impacted by these different events. And we'll be increasing the sophistication of that in the coming years. We've always had these probabilities out here. I know Greg Carvin came and talked to you guys about it fairly recently. Here's a tornado watch. We have the probabilities of the individual hazards. All tornado watches aren't the same. The probabilities are really what distinguish them. But this year, we'll be moving towards translating that into plain language, putting it into our public watches, and we'll start disseminating this more clearly. So it's not just a probabilistic set of numbers. You're going to see in plain language what we're trying to communicate to you in terms of the threat on that particular day. We're also looking at potentially rearranging some of our convective outlook categories. But that we're studying very closely, both with user communities like yourself, as well as media and with social scientists, as to how we can better provide information. We have a lot of information, the probabilities that don't go into our current three-category system, but we don't want to add confusion. That's potentially coming in 2014. We're going to skip over this part, but we're looking at longer range, as well as trying to move towards a continuous stream of information to help you in decision-making and position yourself, particularly in the short range between the watch. This is a depiction of ensembles, all these different computer models brought together to create probabilities of how likely severe storms will come to a particular area. And you can use that to start creating high temporal resolution severe weather outlooks that will give you an idea of when the severe weather should approach your specific community. It should help you in spotting. That's done a lot at the local level. This will all be done in partnership with local forecast offices in terms of better communicating exactly when the risk will be approaching different areas in the country. And that will allow us to move towards more nimble communication strategies, including tornado watches that kind of evolve as the threat evolves, which is very difficult to do within the current structure. So I appreciate your time, and I hope you got something out of that. Main thing is, let's have a plan. Let's stay vigilant. 2011, we don't want a repeat of that, but it will occur again, and I think Chuck will have that message as he looks at the tri-state. These terrible events do occur, and they will occur again in the future, and the main thing is to stay focused and be prepared for them and get our communities prepared for them before they get here. So thank you very much for your time.